And tonight is perfection stage night. And I brought Keith Dalman's Masters of Mahamudra because I wanted to read one or two of the stories. And just to give an idea of the kind of people in India, the Mahasiddhas, the so-called great adepts. Actually, they called them the great sorcerers in the old days, the Europeans, the Zauberer. Oh, hello, Duke, how are you? They called them. And they are some really heavy-duty characters. I wanted to find the one on Naropa. I guess I should look up in there. And there are these 84 Mahasiddhas, the great adepts, which doesn't mean they're the only ones who practice perfection stage to perfection in India, but it just means that these are sort of some famous set of them. And the Hindu Shaivite yogis, they also have 80, and some of them are the same people, probably, with slightly different names. And then, of course, the Tibetans, these are the people, actually, who... there's a lot of good ones here in the beginning, yes. Lilapa, Luyipa. Long ago, so each one of these 84, this Keith Dalman translated, it's from the history, Songs and Histories of the 84 Buddhist Siddhas. He just translates as Siddha, which I translate as adept, one who has attained, who has the attainments. And as I said, they were called sorcerers, actually, in Europe. The Europeans originally called it the Siddha, but it doesn't just mean a magical, but they're magical people. Now the song of Luyipa is, a wild dog with honey rubbed on its nose madly devours whatever it sees. Give the Lama's secret to a worldly fool and his mind and the lineage burn out. That's a good one. For a responsive man with knowledge of the unborn reality, a mere glimpse of the Lama's vision of pure light form destroys mental fiction like an elephant berserk rampaging through hostile ranks with a sword lashed to its trunk. That means when you see the universe as made of light, you know, we've made that point before in other courses that actually we're kind of made of light. And in a way, materialist Western science has almost gotten us there. Also, but we don't connect that with our everyday experience. We think this is like a solid chair, I'm solid bones, you know, flesh and blood. But actually, you know, a supposedly more real model is that it's mostly empty space with a little nucleus and some atoms that's spinning around, mostly empty, right? There's just some little nucleus in there zapping around, but creates this illusion of being solid, you know. You know the joke about the old retired physicist up at Columbia who used to wear snow shoes in his lab? Did I tell you that joke? No? Well, he came there, and whenever he came to the lab, he had a big pair of snowshoes hanging on the wall, and he would put them on and clomp around amongst the different lab experiments. And finally, one of the postdocs worked up their courage, and they said, but Professor blah blah, how come you always clamp around here in snowshoes? And he said, well, I've been working in high energy particle physics for so long that when I come to the lab, I no longer see things in terms of flesh and blood and solid stone and concrete. And I'm sort of aware of the atomic, subatomic nature of things. So I'm increasing my chances of not falling through down into the subway. But that shows that we don't really, that in a way, that is our model of reality. We have that as a model of reality, that's what this, even all this solid stuff is made of, is these atoms. And then we have a kind of solar system model of what an atom is. It doesn't even have as many things, balls spinning around it as a solar system, mostly empty. But we don't, in a way, that's more real, because scientists have discovered that. But we think this is more real, right? So we're into this illusion. So he's saying, that when you have a mere glimpse of the Lama's vision of pure light form, Guru's vision, he really should have tried, this is an Indian text, of pure light form, you know, destroys the mental fiction, meaning all this solidity, like an elephant berserk rampaging through half our ranks with his sword last to his trunk. So that's the song of Luipa. Long ago in the island kingdom of Sri Lanka, a young prince ascended the throne of his fabulously wealthy father. The court astrologers had calculated that the kingdom must be given to the deceased king's second son if it was to remain strong and its people content. In his palace, where the walls were plated with gold and silver and studded with pearls and precious stone, the young king ruled his two brothers and all the people of Sri Lanka. However, possessing nothing but contempt for wealth and power, his only desire was to escape his situation. When he first attempted to escape, his brothers and courtiers caught him and bound him in golden chains. But finally he succeeded in bribing his guards with gold and silver, and at night, disguised in rags, he escaped with a single attendant. He rewarded his faithful accomplice generously before leaving his island kingdom for Rameshwaram, where King Rama reigned. And there he exchanged his golden throne for a simple deerskin and his couch of silks and satin for a bed of ashes. Thus he became a yogi. The king turned yogi was handsome and charming, and he had no difficulty in begging his daily needs. Wandering the length of India, eventually he arrived in Vajrasana, that's a Bodh Gaya, you know, where the Bodhi tree is. The diamond seat is literally, it's called Vajrasana, where the Buddha Shakyamuni had attained enlightenment. There he attached himself to hospitable Dakinis. These are female kind of angelic beings who transmitted to him their Buddhas, actually, mostly, who transmitted to him their feminine insight. From Vajrasana, he traveled to Pataliputra, the king's capital on the river Ganges, that's present-day Patna, where he subsisted on the alms he begged and slept in a cremation ground. Begging in the bazaar one market day, he paused at a house of pleasure, and his karma affected this fateful encounter with a courtesan, who was an incarnate worldly Dakini. Gazing through him at the nature of his mind, the Dakini said, "Your four psychic centers, that is chakras, you know, and their energies are quite pure. But there is a pea-sized obscuration of royal pride in your heart," he said. And with that, she poured some putrid food into his clay bowl and told him to be on his way. He threw the inedible slop into the gutter, whereupon the Dakini, who had been watching him go, shouted after him angrily, "How can you attain nirvana if you're still concerned about the purity of your food?" The yogin was mortified. He realized that his critical and judgmental mind was still subtly active, and he still perceived some things as intrinsically more desirable than others. He also understood that this propensity was the chief obstacle in his progress to Buddhahood. With this realization, he went down to the river Ganges and began a 12-year sadhana to destroy his discursive thought patterns and his prejudices and preconceptions. His practice was to eat the entrails of the fish that the fishermen disemboweled, to transform the fish guts into the nectar of pure awareness by insight into the nature of things as emptiness. The fisherwomen gave him his name, Luipa, which means eater of fish guts. I can't talk. And I'm going to silence it. I apologize. Luipa became a renowned guru, and in the legends of Dharikapa and Dengipa, there is further mention of him. Those were his disciples. And he is one of the three greatest masters of the Chakrasambhara Tantra. Luipa, Kanhapa, and who's the other one? Oh, Gandhapa. Those are the three great ones of the Chakrasambhara, what I call the Super Bliss Machine Buddha, the Chakrasambhara. And Then there's Virupa, who drank beer. So I don't want to spend too much time reading them, but I wanted to read that one. I do love this one also, this which features Avalokiteshvara, actually. And his song, it's called Shabadipa, his name, the hunter. And he was a tribal, actually. He was not a literate, educated person in India. He was a tribal, Shabadipa was. And his song was, in the forest of unknowing lurks a deer. The deer is called alienation. Drawing back the great bow of means and insight, letting fly the single arrow of ultimate truth, the deer dies. Yes, thought dies. Conceptual thought dies, he should say. Never mind. Then the flesh is a feast of non-duality. The flavor is a taste of pure pleasure. And the goal, the magnificent stance, is accomplished. On the slopes of the Vikrama peak in the rugged Mantra mountain chain lived a hunter called Shabadipa. Shabadipa's karma was cursed. The hunter's survival depends on taking life and killing animals and eating their flesh for sustenance results in a rebirth such as that of a hunter. He kills to survive and survives to kill. Seeing his plight, the Bodhisattva of compassion, Lokeshvara, took pity on Shabadipa, and in order to release him from the vicious circle of his karma, he emanated an apparitional hunter similar to Shabadipa. The Bodhisattva met the hunter on the road. Who are you? Asked the hunter suspiciously. I am a hunter like you, the Bodhisattva told him. Where are you from? Asked Shabadipa. Oh, very far away, was the evasive reply. How many deer can you shoot with a single arrow? Shabadipa was very proud of his extraordinary ability with a bow and arrow. 300 or so, said the Bodhisattva. I'd like to see you try, said Shabadipa scornfully. So the next morning, the Bodhisattva led Shabadipa out to a wide plain where they found a herd of 500 deer, which Lokeshvara had conjured. That's Avalokiteshvara, right? There you are, said the hunter derisively. How many will you shoot? Oh, all 500. Why not shoot 100 to start with, Shabadipa suggested, somewhat disconcerted. So the Bodhisattva shot 100 deer with a single arrow. And then he asked the hunter to carry one home for him. When Shabadipa could not lift the weight of the single deer, his pride suddenly broke. When they reached home, Shabadipa begged the Bodhisattva to teach him how to shoot, as he did. Lokeshvara promised to do so, but he stipulated that Shabadipa should not eat meat for a month. The hunter and his wife became vegetarians, abandoning their lifelong habit of killing animals. The Bodhisattva returned after only a week, and discovering that they were obeying his injunction, he told Shabadipa that if he wanted archery instruction, he should contemplate loving kindness and compassion for all living creatures, in addition to renouncing meat eating. The Bodhisattva's inducement was sufficient to make the hunter agree unhesitatingly. When the month had passed and the Bodhisattva returned, Shabadipa greeted him eagerly. But Lokeshvara first drew a mandala for the hunter and his wife, and after strewing flowers upon it, he invited them to gaze into it. What do you see? He asked them. Looking into the magic circle, they saw themselves burning in the 8 great hells, and paralyzed with horror, they could not speak. What do you see? What do you see? Repeated the Bodhisattva. Ourselves burning in hell, Shabadipa finally exclaimed. Aren't you afraid? He asked. Yes, afraid, was Shabadipa. Do you want to know how to avoid it? Surely, replied the hunter. But are you able to do what is necessary? Receiving a final affirmation, the Bodhisattva began to explain the basic tenets of the Buddha's teaching. The inevitable long-term effect of taking life is rebirth in a human hell. The immediate short-term effect is strengthened inclination to kill, so that there is an acute danger of compounding your sin. And there's also a strong possibility that your own life will be cut short as you have shortened others' lives. The social effect is dishonor and a vile reputation. On the other hand, by renouncing activity that involves taking life, you can achieve enlightenment. As renunciation becomes a habit and the tendency to kill diminishes, you accumulate immense merit and virtue and the probability of a long life increases. Finally, your reputation improves and respect and honor accrue. So he starts right at the beginning, even though this is tantric adept. In that way, Lokeshwara taught them the karmic effects of virtue and vice, the 10 virtuous actions and their antitheses, showing them the inevitable retribution that results from unpropitious acts and the benefits of a meritorious mode of existence. Gaining insight into the state of pain inherent in the wheel of life and feeling remorse and disgust for the way he had lived, Shabaripa was inspired to irreversible faith in the path of the Buddha. Lokeshwara gave him a full-time sadhana to practice and then sent him to Danti Mountain to meditate. For 12 years, Shabaripa meditated upon undirected and unstructured sublime compassion in a thought-free state, and he attained the supreme realization of Mahamudra. Mahamudra means the great embrace, or actually, literally the great seal, like a, not the one with the ball on its nose, not that seal. Seal like you impress in wax, a seal, you know. And the great seal, which I think should be called the great embrace, is where you are sort of impressed in the wax of the great bliss voidness, the bliss void indivisible, where you experience your relationship to the entire universe as a kind of communion, an ecstatic communion, something like that. Then one day, awakening out of his samadhi of sublime compassion, he sought his guru, the Bodhisattva Lokeshwara. When he found him, the guru praised his achievement profusely and then gave him further instruction. O lucky man, your supreme nirvana is not the nirvana of those who wish with single-minded purpose to extinguish root passion and finally life itself, like shepherds putting out a grass fire. In this course, have I not emphasized very much that the true nirvana, the true liberation, is right here in the midst of everything, right? Not the one where you, everything is all finished and you leave and go somewhere else, right? I hope I've explained that sufficiently, because it is so ingrained in people, you know, in the misunderstanding, and not only in Buddhism, every kind of notion of sort of enlightenment, sainthood, is like disappearing in some other place, you know. Like shepherds putting out a grass fire. You must stay on the wheel of life. Oh, you're a bodhisattva. You must stay on the wheel of life for the sake of all those bound to it. Your aim should be to release an infinite number of people. Shabaripa returned to his own country and stayed there. He was called by three different names: Shabaripa, Mapchi Gochen, and Rijagumpo. You know, these are, he doesn't know the Sanskrit of those, the second two names, neither do I right away. He transmits his meaning to those with propitious karma through song and dance, sound and symbol, and he will stay on earth until Maitreya, the Buddha of love, the next Buddha, appears and teaches the gospel of the new age. So that's a really good one. I like that. Here, some of them are rather funny, but I don't want to spend too much time reading. Then there's Aryadeva. Actually, Aryadeva is my own namesake. When I was a young monk with the Tibetans, they called me Aryadeva. That was one of their names, because I have one eye. And Aryadeva lost one eye. You know? He was Nagarjuna's disciple, Aryadeva. He's the foremost disciple of Nagarjuna. But he was a kind of miraculous emanation, not like me. Ordinary flesh and blood, he was something extraordinary. And it's very funny, his relationship to Nagarjuna. And anyway, there's a lot of great stories. He's considered also, Aryadeva and Nagarjuna both are considered patriarchs in the lineage of Zen. You know, Zen, Chan in China and Zen in Japan, came from Bodhidharma. Even though Western scholars always try to prove there was no such person, but there was. And the Zen people certainly think so. Who came from actually Sri Lanka. Because Sri Lanka was not sort of uptight Theravada place in the ancient time. It was a full-scale Indian Buddhist place with Theravada, of course, wonderful Theravada, great Mahayana, and Vajrayana, all together. Which was the general model in India until they destroyed it. India's Buddhist side of India's culture was destroyed by invasions 1,000 years ago. And then after that happened, then Sri Lanka reverted back to just being only Theravada. But anyway, Bodhidharma came from there, and he was obviously a tantric adept, Bodhidharma. And So in a secret way, in Chan, and therefore Zen, there is Tantra in there, actually. It's a kind of Tantra. And they consider Aryadeva and Nagarjuna to be there. They're patriarchs in their lineage before coming to China. And it's a long story, though. I don't want to read it. It's a little bit too long. I have too much to do tonight. I recommend this book, Keith Dauman. It's very good. He's a friend of mine, lives in Nepal. And he's called Masters of Mahamudra. But I mean, it's the 84 great adepts. I don't know why he has to come up with that title. But it's a fun book. There's nice stories in it. You'll find the one there, the one that I told you, I think, already, about the guy who slept his way to Buddhahood. I told you that, right? Remember that? I didn't tell you that in this class? No? Oh, I'll just tell you myself. There was this one yogi who Nagarjuna, I think, found him, came to some town and found him outside the town in a cremation ground, in a, you know, cemetery, basically. And he was crying, but he was well dressed and he was healthy looking, and he was kind of lying there like that, and he was weeping. So Nagarjuna said, "What's the matter with you? You're like a young guy, healthy, like, what's wrong with you?" "I didn't tell you the story." Oh my goodness. He told his story to Nagarjuna, which was, he was a weirdo. He had a nice wife, even children, parents, and all one of those extended family compounds. But at a certain point in his life, he decided all he really wanted to do was sleep. That's all he did. So he slept all the time. He would wake up, you know, go to the bathroom, eat something, and then go back to sleep. And that was all he did. So finally, everybody got sick of him. He said, "They're all sick of me." And they said, "Look, if you're going to lie around the house like a dead man, we don't need you here in the house. We'll take you to where they have the dead men. You go there, and we'll leave you there." Because, of course, they thought that would rouse him up, right? But he was lying there in the remaining ground thing. He didn't care. He knew they had abandoned him, and he was crying because they wouldn't be taking care of him. But he still, that's all he was. If he went back, he would annoy them because he would just sleep, because that's all he liked to do. So then Arjuna says, "You are really unusual. That is very, very interesting that you have this, you've come to this new mode of living. And actually, it could be quite advantageous for you." And he said, "You know, you can just stay if you like, but if you like, I can give you some teaching. And if you had that certain teaching, you can keep sleeping. And you can sleep as long as you like, and you'll be amazed what could happen to you. You could become a Buddha by sleeping." "Oh, I'd like that. Would you like that?" He said, "Yes, I would really like that." So then Nagarjuna initiated him into Grihasamaja or Hevaja or something, one of the unexcelled yoga tantras. And he specially taught him how to mix the clear light of sleep with the clear light of death and the clear light of Buddhahood. You know, the Dharma, which is the Dharmakaya, you know, the bliss void, indivisible Dharmakaya, you know, or Mahamudra, whatever they want to call it, a great embrace. And so then he was very happy, so then he went back to sleep. And then the family was really weirded out because he was just lying in this cemetery sleeping all the time. And the animals were, you know, the predators didn't come and eat him, and he wasn't dying, and he looked fine. And then finally the wife came and looked at night, and then at night there were all these dakinis, these like angels, and it was all luminous, and they were feeding him nectars and anointing him with pure energy and all this kind of thing. And he was happily sleeping. So then after 12 years of this yoga, of the sleep yoga, his sleeping body levitated. But this might be my addition. It's in there. I think it's called Kadgapa. He levitated, and then staying asleep, he floated downtown and around the village and around the town. And then without waking up, he started teaching the Dharma to the people and to his family and everything. So showing the non-duality of waking and sleeping. I really like that one. It's that one that we derive, you know, at Menla Mountain Retreat, where we teach retreats, you know, Tibet houses, Tibet medicine-oriented, medicine Buddha retreat place up north from here. I teach a sleep yoga there, but I can share it with you all. When you fall asleep at night, never think. And you do that, you do so in a darkened room, right? And you turn off the lights and it's you quiet and et cetera, you know? And so you think you're lying in a darkened room. And then when you go unconscious, you could be nothing, right? You sort of, your mind is blank nothing. But don't think ahead of time, and I'm not saying you will change that. You should definitely conk out and sleep, of course. It's a precious thing for your health and everything. But before you do, don't think you're going to be lying in a dark space of nothingness. And use inference to realize that that's not what actually happens. What is the inference? If I was lying in a bed of nothingness, I would not be energized and refreshed in the morning. I'd feel just like I did when I fell asleep because it would be nothing. So there would be no new energy from anywhere. So I must be drawing, some energy must be coming to me when I'm unconscious. And that's because beneath, remember the eight stages of dissolution of the Book of the Dead? We went over that many times. You know, moonlight, sunlight in the bottom levels, moonlight, sunlight, dark light. Remember that? After you get rid of being connected to your coarse body and your coarse senses. Remember, we went over that. You're all familiar with that. So beneath the dark light, where you do lose consciousness, so your ordinary self-centered consciousness, is the clear light. And the clear light is this strange thing, which seems to be a place where you withdraw from everything and are disconnected from it all. But it is not just the same as the black light where you're unconscious. You're unconscious and conscious at the same time. You're not in some micro place, like isolated from everything. From the clear light, you have an awareness that is that's one with everything. And actually, in the clear light, you are Buddha. So when you're totally passed out, you're a Buddha. But it doesn't do you a lot of good because you don't remember it. Because it's covered over with the layer of unconsciousness in the normal person. But when you die, it's the same thing. That's what death is defined. That's where the consciousness continuum of a person hits that clear light. And you know, they have a whole thing about it's in the center of the heart chakra and the indestructible drop, all this kind of thing. But never mind about that. But the point is that therefore, at that point, at that moment, the continuum expands into infinity. And it's everything, everywhere. And it's, you know, unconsciousness and consciousness is no different than anything else. And it's just like, it's inconceivable and inexpressible, of course. So I'm saying all the things, but none of them capture this. But because it's become infinite, then that's when the connection with the previous coarse body is finally completely severed. And the previous subtle body, which is the nervous system. Right? And then it shoots off. But the reason that it shoots off, it doesn't really shoot off. Because at the clear light, it's also permeating the existing body. The body that's supposedly dead now is also permeated because there's no limit to the awareness of a Buddha and of you when you're in that state. So you actually don't leave the body, but we leave the body because we're not used to identifying ourselves as being vast, empty, clear light, transparency. And clear light is even a misleading translation because it's not light. Its analogy is the gray pre-dawn twilight. And that state is infinite, and our awareness is infinite in that state, and our awareness is no different from the awareness of all enlightened beings, and actually all unenlightened beings. The only difference between the two is that the unenlightened ones don't know that that's their awareness, so they're not having a good time. They're thinking they're a separate alienated person. Like you said, the deer is alienation. The arrow of ultimate reality, which is clear light transparency, hits that alienation and it kills it. And then the feast is the bliss of being this infinite being, one with all Buddhas and all beings. And then the manifestation, of course, is you're not unaware also of all the beings who don't know that that's their true nature as well and are still trapped by the deer of alienation, you could say. They're alienated, so they're feeling freaked out. And we also do, so when we die, when we're not enlightened, we pass that state. It's like when you look through a pane of glass, you never stop your vision at the point of going through the pane of glass, does not stop and look laterally in through the glass. It's like you're immediately on the other side. So then we won't, and we're used to, although it's alienating to have this separated body from everything, and everything else is against it, and we're frightened of it all, and we want to like own it all or whatever, you know, because we're having this hopeless situation of alienation, right? Second noble truth. And so we immediately, but then we're used to that, and we think that's the only way to be safe. So we produce a new body. We try to find a new way of embodying ourselves instantly, or what we think is instantly. You know, they say in Book of the Dead, you stay out of consciousness for 3 or 4 days, you can, at the point you die. Which means that you're actually bathing in that clear light, but you think you're unconscious because you're stuck on the dark light immanence state, which holds the, which covers over the clear light, like it puts an envelope around it, so that you don't become reconscious of unconscious, because you're not used to identifying yourself as infinite. You can't. You don't know how to do that, because you didn't practice that. You didn't receive the teaching of emptiness equals relativity, right? Which is exoteric, but it's the same teaching as esoteric. Don't ever believe anybody who tells you that Tantra has a different theory of reality. That's why it's so cool, it's so cute. That's baloney. Same theory of reality, different method of entering this Buddhahood, that's all, and we're accelerating. And how do you enter? That's what we're going to talk about today. How do you enter that? You enter that through the perfection stage. And for example, that guy who was sleeping in the clear light, he was merging his life, his sleep clear light with his death clear light while still alive, and the Buddhahood clear light. But it took a long time to merge the three completely. So that's why he had to sleep for 12 years in that particular context. But he slept in that setting, and the setting was where he had melted himself into emptiness by the subject, with the subjectivity of great bliss. The subjectivity that can know emptiness is the bliss that dissolves into emptiness. So it's no longer the subjectivity of the alienated being who, like, I'm here and I know that. Not at all. Nobody ever gets to know emptiness like that. Conceptually, we can sort of know that by a concept, but experience, we cannot that way. Have to melt into it. And what melt? When do we melt? One of the times in our life when we melt. Relief of bliss. I'm always so frustrated. Well, actually, I shouldn't say always, because I've only had sodium pentothal once or twice in the dentist chair. And I'm so frustrated, because I'm looking forward to the release of not being there. It would be such a, not worrying about whatever it is. Not living in the war zone, you know. And the problem is, because I'm not trained and I just think it's an unconsciousness. It's like when you sleep at night, aren't you frustrated? When you finally fall asleep, and then bing, the alarm goes off and you have to get up. And there's no sense of time when you're unconscious, right? Absolutely not. And that's why Buddha is not fixed in any particular time. Because consciousness and unconsciousness are no different to the clear light bliss mind. There's no difference between being conscious and unconscious, which is indescribable, right? We can't understand that. We should say, I'll be one or the other, right? But I think it has a meaning. Actually, the fourth formless state, according to which I also told you about way back in Theravada, when we were doing Theravada like two months ago, the fourth formless state is the state beyond consciousness and unconsciousness, remember? The Hindus think when they achieve that, you're enlightened, Turiya. So there must be a way where a great yogi can go into that state, but then somehow stay on the event horizon or threshold of it, as if it were a formless state, and not be open to that state permeating in transparency all differentiated things and all being. So they then think non-duality means to be in some separated state. So that's very close to the state, but because they have set a concept that there's this escape place that's like that. It's not that they don't come back. It's that they somehow still have enough of ignorance that they have become, hold themselves in being unconscious of the differentiated state. Do you follow me? The illusory, of course, the differentiated state is illusory in this when you think it's the only state. But when you experience the differentiated state of you and other beings, in other words, you and other Buddhas, when you experience that without leaving the state of absolute transparency, both being the same, and that as an inconceivability, then that's Buddhahood. But short of that, you're just stuck as a god of the formless realm. That's really interesting. Don't you think that's interesting? That's why the Brahmins, but and also I think they can't really stay there. And they must be gods who get stuck in formless realm. Actually, all of us have done so, by the way. Remember the inference of beginninglessness is that we've all been formless state yogis. We've all attained Buddhahood already, all of us. And we tried to stay there a long time. But you know, the really frustrating thing for a deity of the formless realm is precisely the frustrating thing when you go to sleep at night. You wake up right away, and it's 12 hours later, and you're sitting, and you know, you didn't want to get up yet. Right? Because there's no sense of time when you're unconscious. And beyond consciousness and unconsciousness means both conscious and unconscious, of course. It means same, virtually same. Right? So that's to me really interesting. So anyway, I had a hit one time. There is a bodhisattva called Akashagarbha, essence of space, or womb of space. And his job is to go around and get those deities of the formless realm back to business. Because, you know, a paranoid person would never want to leave a place where no one else was there to bug you. And it seems like an absolute infinite thing that you're in this infinite space, infinite consciousness, total unconsciousness, and beyond consciousness and unconsciousness, those four planes. That would be, it's perfect. You couldn't be bothered with rent or Trump or anything. Nothing. They could blow up the planet 100 times, you wouldn't mind. You wouldn't even know. But the frustrating thing is also, you have no sense of time of being away from it all, and then you're instantly back. And it's a new universe. And it's probably a worse president than Trump. So it's very interesting. But anyway, and in a way, you know, the Brahmins in India, the yogis, during Buddhist times somewhat, but most of them joined the Buddhist university when Buddhism was there, most of the really bright ones. Because it's not that rocket science, non-duality is not that complicated, really. But after it was left, and there was nobody there to kind of whack them, you know, when they were, you know, there's a famous Zen story, you know, about the guy who had the door slammed on his leg, you know that one? In Chan, the Chinese Chan, I shouldn't say Zen, Chan story. Well, there was this one famous story that people used to use to make an excuse for crazy wisdom people, you know, who were actually treating people badly, and they pretended it was all crazy wisdom. So they used this story as an excuse, which is a big misunderstanding. But anyway, there's a famous story that this one Zen master, I forget his name, Chan master, he had a very top disciple who was doing deep meditation for years. And he would, you know, in the Chan tradition, you go now and then and you meet your teacher and he poses something or he tests you or gives you a new thing to meditate on or whatever it is, you know, what they call the interview, you know. So he used to come to his teacher's room at the appointed moment to have an interview, and then every time for like a decade, the teacher would say to him, say something about emptiness or get out, and then would push him out of the room. And because he couldn't think of what to say, so he would always get pushed out. So then finally, one time, after a long time, he'd had some sort of satori experience. So he came in and the guy said, as usual, say something about emptiness or get out. And then he was like, no, I'm not getting out. I have something to say. But he didn't have, and then he was trying to stay, and the guy was violently pushing him out. And then he still had his one leg in the door, and then the guy slammed some big Chan monastery door on his leg and broke it. And with the breaking of the bone, he became enlightened. So, you know, they use this as a... But I reject that, because he never broke anybody else's bone. You know, he wasn't going around breaking everybody's bone. He didn't break the guy's bone for every day for 20 years, you know, just this one time. And then they say, then the commentator, the Zen commentator, Chan commentator writes, like, he broke one bone, but he was saved by that one breaking from having a whole planet full of the skeletons of the bodies of the different animals he would have, humans and animals he would have been before he got to this point of enlightenment if that hadn't happened to him. You know? So he jumped over millions of lifetimes. The famous Chan and Zen that pretends they don't need former future life. It's right there in their own chronicles. You know? And what does that mean? That means that he, when he said he had something to say at emptiness, he was going to report that he had disappeared. He'd had an infinite kind of space vision or luminous when he'd reached that state. And so he had to say, I reached there. He was going to say it. You know, he was trying to stay in the room to say that to his guru. But the guru was not accepting that because he had the false view in his mind that that state he reached was ultimate reality, not this. So when the guru did that, pushed him, forced him back into relativity, and even the pain of the bone breaking, mixing with his awareness of emptiness, broke him into a kind of non-duality clear light, if you follow me. You get it? Like you think, you're like a certain person we all know, a certain so-called American geisha who goes around, I realize emptiness, or I'm great. That's totally fake. But that's fake. That's a sad delusion. Nobody owns the realization of emptiness. Buddha never says, you know, in Prajna Paramita Sutra, that anybody who says, I realize emptiness is messed up. They're wrong. Because you don't realize emptiness. You give yourself away. And that is, you open yourself through bliss. You let go of everything. You don't own anything. You don't own any experience. Absolutely not. You give yourself away. And you discover you are everybody else. All those people who didn't, who don't know their emptiness. You're all of them. You're burdened with all of their things. Luckily, you're feeling so blissful you can manage. Supposedly, I hope. Don't we all hope that? So then, okay, perfection stage. So, let's look at some text on perfection. Hello. Ding, ding, ding. Hello. Ah, there you are. Bless me to realize here in this life. That's okay. Never mind about that. Bless me to realize here in this life the path of clear light, magic body, communion. Coming from you, Savior, when you put your toe in my eight-petaled heart center, Dhuti nerve. Dhuti, Abhadhuti is a name for a central channel. And the eight-petaled heart center is where the indestructible drop, wrapped in the red and white energies, when the Star of David, you know, the double triangle, six-fold heart knot of the right and left white and red channels releases, which happens normally in death, but it also happens in samadhi of this type, more delicately unraveled. And then the savior, that's his guru, Nata, protector, is referring to, you know, not just protector, but it's the savior. When you put your toe in my eight-petaled heart-centered duty nerve, that's his guru. This is Panchen Lama's saying this. If the path is not complete and death arrives, so if I haven't done that and then I come to sort of normal death, but I'm not really ready for it because I haven't achieved the transparency magic body communion. If the path is not complete and death arrives, bless me to go to a pure Buddha verse by the instruction for implementing the five powers of mentor soul ejection. That's POA, soul ejection. That's what I call it. I call it soul transmission. They say soul transference. But it's better soul ejection. You know, like when you crash a jet airplane, if you're a pilot, and before it crashes, you press a button and then you... when your parachute opens, right? That's ejection. So that's a tradition where you find this certain subtle drop, and then at the moment of death, you shoot it up through the crown chakra into the universe of Akshobhya Buddha, where Milarepa hangs out, where all the siddhas are. And it's sort of a tantric Buddha land. The forceful art of Buddhahood. In short, life after life forever, you, Savior, care for me, that's his guru, care for me never apart. Bless me to become your foremost child, upholding all the secrets of body, speech, and mind. You, Savior, at your perfect Buddhahood, may I be foremost in your retinue. Grant me good luck for easy, spontaneous achievement of all my goals, temporary and ultimate. Thus, having prayed, may you, Supreme Mentor, joyously come to my crown to bless me. Sit surely, your toenails glistening in the, this should not be pistil. I always mix up parts of flowers. It should be pericarp. I apologize. In the pericarp of my heart center. That is the lotus of the heart center. Pericarp is the part of the flower where the pollen is, you know. And that's where the moon, sun, Rahu disc is, where sits the Vajradhara being, something like that. That's a little bit of the verse of the Penjin Rinpoche, you know, in his famous Guru Puja book, you know, Lama Chöpa. Okay, that's his part that has to do. And then clear light and magic body. So that will start at the top. So you know that, right? I've talked about that before, right? The fifth stage of the five perfection stages, which can be counted as 6 or 7, actually. But anyway, they usually say, they try to say 5, and then there are different ways they count the 5. The fifth stage, which is Buddhahood, is the stage of communion, I call it. People call it just union. I used to call it integration, actually, when I published this book. Because I like Carl Jung, so I was going integration. And that's not wrong, neither one is wrong, union or integration. But communion is better because the Latin com means together and signifies that there are two things there. And then there's a union of two things, but they're still the two things. So they're both one and two, in other words. So there's Buddhahood is both body and mind, not just mind. And actually, of course, at Buddhahood level, there's no difference between body and mind. So sometimes it's useful to think of it all as mind. And actually, you can also think of it all as body. That's also perfectly all right. Because neither one of those dualistic things actually capture the inconceivability of actual reality, which is beyond body-mind, including body-mind, we can say, right? Well, you can't ever finish saying stuff about it, because there is no final statement of it, which is why dear old Vimalakirti didn't say anything. But he got there. Remember the Dharma door of non-duality? Did you read the Vimalakirti? Did you read it? The teaching of Vimalakirti Sutra, when we were back in that part of the class, because you've been here the whole time, I think. So, this class, when we read Vimalakirti, you know, the holy teaching of Vimalakirti. In the 9th chapter, he talks about non-duality, but then he doesn't say anything. That's very important. So now here's Nagarjuna's thing. That's a communion, right? And what are the two things that are in union? The fourth state is called clear light, or manifest enlightenment. And that's one of the two things, is the infinite clear light, inconceivable, blah, 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 associated with the female, associated with wisdom, that clear light, associated with the mother tantras, like Chakra Sambhara, Hevajra, Kalachakra, etc. There are many others. And then the third stage is the one where there piles up a lot of things. But the highest level of the third stage is called the magic body, by me. Other people call illusion body, because they rudely translate Maya only as illusion. You know, even Buddha's mother, they call her the illusion goddess, instead of the magic goddess. And we can say in English, right? We can call a magician an illusionist, right? We use illusion in that way too. But illusionist is sort of more esoteric, you know, some sort of low budget movie, they say illusionist, and otherwise they say magician. Doctor Strange is a magician, right? So magician is one who works with illusion. And Maya Devi, the Buddha's mother, is the magic goddess. And she's a miraculous person, you know. And the Buddhas are miraculous persons because they realize that the universe is this inconceivable thing, this pure energy, pure light. And therefore they can shape and reshape whatever it is, they can manifest infinitely, whatever, supposedly. And which I think logically makes sense. But, you know, I can't know for sure because I'm not a Buddha. But I intend to be, and then I think I'll be corroborated. So that's the third stage. But actually then the third stage has other stages in between as well. It has other names. Another name for the third stage is the mind objective. And another name for the third stage is the mind isolation. But in a way, those are almost different stages. So in a way, you could say that mind isolation and then mind objective lead to magic body. So in a way, there's three parts of the third stage. And this will be important for what we talk about, what's called Dzogchen, great perfection, the Nyingma way of dividing the unexcelled yoga tantras, where they divide it into three levels of tantra, Mahayoga, Anuyoga, and Atiyoga. And actually our last class on the 14th, and by the way, remember there's no class on Monday. I originally scheduled another class on Monday because I thought I wouldn't be back from Italy today, but I managed to escape from Naples yesterday. And so we held this class. I mean, I knew that from some time back. And so I'm not holding a class on Monday. But just on the final class of the whole course, I'll be joined by the wonderful Dr. Nida Chenaksang, great doctor and great Nyingma yogi, and Ngakpa, like a shaman or something almost. And we're going to look at his book, his new book, this one, called The Mirror of Light, Commentary on Yutok's Ati Yoga. So we're going to be talking about Ati Yoga. And I'm going to introduce it by, I'm going to connect this Ati Yoga and Dzogchen with Dzogrim. You know, the great perfection Dzogrim is the same word in Tibetan as the Dzogchen. They say there are different Sanskrit words that are sometimes used, which is true. But in Tibetan, they're the same word. And my theory is that the second part, or the last third of the third stage of the usual way of counting the perfection stages, this 2.66, so the last third of that stage plus fourth and fifth stage are the Ati Yoga. And the earlier part of the Dzogrim is the Anu Yoga. And then the Kyedim, the creation stage, is the Mahayoga. That's my, and I think other people have held that theory as well, Tibetans. And I really think that's correct. I think Dalai Lama also agrees with that. Well, that's important, as I've told you, that the root of pernicious sectarianism in Tibetan Buddhism, or actually in any tradition, is somebody saying that only we have this highest, best, greatest thing. You know, nobody else has it, just us. That's like monopoly. You know, you have to trust bust when you run into that. That's monopolization of the path to enlightenment, which people like His Holiness don't like, and I don't like. And Shakyamuni didn't like, actually. So that's important. So then the third stage, so then coming back to the third stage. So then third stage, what happens in the third stage is mind isolation is where mind becomes isolated from anything impure, imperfect. And it connects sort of phenomenologically with, for the first time, the person consciously reaches clear light awareness by all energies dissolving into sun and moon energies. The right-hand channel is sun, left-hand is moon. Dissolve into the central channel, the avaduti channel, the madhyama mula, the central channel. And then the person achieves the simultaneous death experience, bliss, death, life experience. In other words, first time consciously, fully grasps the clear light, which when you do, you're both infinite and completely embedded in everything, the full grasp of it. When you come to the edge of it, you might think that it's just a deeper level of disappearing from everything. But that would be wrong, because everything that, from that perspective, is made of this clear light. It is this. It's also, you haven't left anything when you really achieve that. And that's called the mind isolation, is, and mind objective, therefore, are kind of the same thing. And so there's a way of knowing that where you are all of it simultaneously, it seems. And then magic body arises within that, because then your continuum of your alienated subjectivity that you had when you were a separated or alienated being, the continuum of it enjoys being non-alienated and completely one with everything else in an unlimited repertory of forms. And none of those forms depart from that clear light. They are also the clear light. And therefore, they only seem to be forms to beings with whom you interact, who they think they're separate from you. You don't think you're separate from them. They think they're separate from you. And they think they're separate from any kind of clear light. And so you then meet them in their realm of their expectation, as something separate from them, seeming separate from them. And yet you, in appearing to them like that, you know you're not separate from you. Every cell, every fiber of your being knows you're not separate from them. And you also are them, and of course everybody else simultaneously. So it's indescribable. It's like that flower ornament sutra things, you know. It's like every atom and every, you know, Samantabhadra is in it everywhere. This whole universe is in every atom. Like a hologram, you know. You are like a living hologram yourself. That's a magic body. But when you first get the magic body, there's still a vestige of your own sense of separateness, because you're not yet at Buddhahood. There's still a tiny vestige of your feeling, wow, I'm magic body, I'm something like that. Not necessarily verbally saying that or having the concept of that, but somewhere, because unraveling the alienated, evolutionary, instinct-driven being is such a huge, huge effort. So, but you're on the edge of that, you have magic body. And in order to have that magic body be something viable, that's why you've had to practice the creation stage. Because it's like you can learn to lucidly dream. But when you lucidly dream, your body is just a figment of your own imagination, in a way, in the dream. But the lucidity comes from, oh, I'm in a dream, and I don't need to wake up to know that I'm here. But when you lucidly dream, you still are, your body is subject to the environment in such a way that if you have a nightmare, your body might turn into a porcupine to hold off the nightmare creatures, you know, with quills, you know, with poison sharp quills or something. In other words, you don't control the shape of your body because you don't have the mental stability to do that. Okay? So the creation stage, you know, you visualize yourself as a Vajrayogini, female Buddha, or Tara, female Buddha pretending to be Bodhisattva. Or Avalokiteshvara, male Bodhisattva, Buddha pretending to be Bodhisattva. Or Manjushri, male Buddha pretending to be Bodhisattva. Or Chakrasambhara, super bliss machine Buddha, male and female both in union. Or Kalachakra with Vishwamata, the universal mother, in union. Or Guhyasamaja with Mamaki in union, etc. Whether it's a couple, whether you are a couple, whether you are an individual, or the Lone Ranger form of Chakrasambhara, or the female Lone Ranger form of Chakrasambhara called the Vajrayogini. Whatever you developed when you were still stably in your coarse body, but you were a great yogi, you were initiated into the holographic pattern, by a mentor, guru, savior, lama, who really had achieved something like that themselves, or even if one hadn't achieved that, somewhere in their ancestry someone did achieve that, and they are respectful enough of that that they allow that to channel through them and don't exploit it for their own egocentric purpose, and et cetera, et cetera. And they just become an open channel for that and transmit the transmission, the initiation, which is just the holographic pattern. It's not power and energy and all that's a bunch of baloney. It's an anointment. So because you then practice that creation stage, and you know, like forearmed Avalokiteshvara, you receive the initiation of forearmed Avalokiteshvara, and not just the Kriya Tantra version, or the Charya Tantra version, or the Yoga Tantra version, where in a way mainly you kind of visualize Avalokiteshvara as in front of you, and you have blessings streaming towards you, and you mentally make offering, etc. You develop a relationship in those earlier tantras, and you have a purifying sort of thing with him. But the unexcelled yoga tantra, where you merge with that being, and then you feel yourself having four arms, holding a lotus and a crystal rosary and a jewel of universal compassion in your front two hands, and your body is white, and etc. And you have big earlobes, and you feel that's your body. And you have become where you go into a meditative state in through the creation stage, where you really do feel that is your body. You don't feel. And like right now, you're looking at me, or you're making notes, or you're looking with your eyes, you're writing with your hand, you know, you're hearing with your ears, you know, you're smelling, you have the aftertaste of dinner, you know, all your senses are functioning, but you're paying attention to some particular one. But you don't really, and you automatically have an image of yourself as a being with male or female, with two shoulders, two arms, hands, you know, this is all there, but you're not sort of feeling every part of this embodiment. You're just sort of present at this point, you know, whatever it is. You can kind of look around, oh yeah, I still got my feet, my arm, my legs, but you're not thinking about it. So you, the creation stage, you take being four-armed Avalokiteshvara or multi-armed Yamantaka or whatever different complicated or uncomplicated thing you're doing, and you really feel you are that. You have replaced in your brain the image of yourself, you know, the pattern of yourself, with that of one of those deities. But since you're doing it in the creation stage with the artistry of emptiness, or let's say with the artistry of the paintbrush of compassion and love, you've drawn it on the mirror of emptiness. So and it is emptiness, and you know that. So you can move back and forth, actually. You're not stuck. But the point is, you can, if you decide, I am Avalokiteshvara, or I am Vajrayogini, in the magic body state, in the perfection stage, where you have achieved the mind isolation and the mind objective, and where you really disappear in clear light, in a way, any kind of body image, you then can kind of clamp onto yourself the body image of Aguya Samaja, or Yamantaka, or Vajrayogini. And then that's your magic body. Do you follow me? And you really need that at that time, because you're in this subtle plane. It's why responsible Tibetan teachers don't really so much teach dream yoga in real detail to people who don't have bodhisattva vow, that they their whole purpose in life, their main vehicle of energy, their soul dedication is to Buddhahood for the sake of all beings, that like there's a core energy of altruism. I learned a word in Italy, allocentrismo, allocentrism, you know, like allopathic, you know. Allo means in Latin other, as opposed to ego and allo. Allocentrico instead of egocentrico. So if someone's very altruistic, you say they're allocentrico. Although then other people tell me that's a high word, it's not a colloquial word in Italian. So, never mind. So that's your bodhisattva vow. You know, bodhisattva mind, bodhisattva spirit. And also have some level of detachment from the instincts. And also have some sort of medicine of the royal reason of relativity, even if they haven't experienced emptiness, some sense of, not emptiness, but space like equipoise side of it. They, by inference, they know anything they experience is relative. They very firmly have that as an inference with reasoning and strong conviction. And so then that person, because otherwise, you know, lucid dreaming is gets you in a lot of, because the dream state is this sort of subtle state, and you can meet weird entities there, and you know, it can be, you can get in trouble with the dream thing. If you have to have some kind of mandala, you know, protection in dream state. And so that's the magic party thing, because that's like bardo. The magic party is in the same plane as the between state after death, and it's in the same plane as the dream state. But then in that state, you're in this subtle plane. So what is the point of that magic party? As the magic party, you can develop immense merit. You can, because you're like in a virtual reality, where you can then enter the fourth stage of the perfection stage, which is called the clear light stage, or the manifest enlightenment stage, which is a place where you plunge the third stage magic body into the fourth stage clear light again and again and again, which actually means subjectively experience. You experience death again and again and again, but without actually dying. In other words, your body, your ordinary, your previous yogi's coarse body or yogini's coarse body is there in a sort of balanced, suspended animation, hibernating state, which you can return to. But you can then gain the merit of many lives and deaths, of many bodhisattva lives and deaths, where you generously gave of your life, of your time, of your attention, of your possessions, of your bloodstream, of whatever it is. You gave and gave and gave and gave and gave. And you can pack the same amount of merit of millions of meat space lifetimes. You can pack that into some period of meditation, 12 years in this burning, in this sound asleep. He was dreaming in that sound asleep state, of course. But he was lucidly dreaming as the magic body after some time, that guy who attained yoga. He wasn't just in the state of clear light all the time. Or rather, in the state of clear light, he consciously was rising in meditational states. You follow? So it's very sci-fi and very incredible, and maybe it's all one giant vast illusion that modern scholars think so. Modern Buddhological scholars, they all think it is. They think, oh, that's crazy, they're not really doing that. And even a lot of Buddhists think so. And they think, oh, never mind, we don't need creation. Say, we'll just jump into straight clear light, and great perfection, clear light, great seal, we'll be fine, no problem, we'll be Buddhas. And His Holiness is very happy with that. And he has one famous statement he makes to people like that. He says, good luck. Good luck. Because you realize, you see, that theoretically, and why he says that is because theoretically, when you unravel the central heart knot carefully through, well, now we're going to go back from the third stage into the second and the first and the creation stage. Sometimes the creation stage is connected to the first as a part of the unexcelled yoga, the five stages, you know. But when you do that, that happens to you anyway at death. This unravels at death, but you can't control it at normal death, and then you will leave your body, actually. You will. You know all those things in the near-death experiences, if you've ever read that, you should actually read those books. Try to look up even the crazy ones. You know, Embraced by the Light, Heaven Can't Wait, there's a million of them nowadays. They can't be, some of them are probably definitely genuine, some are maybe genuine. But anyway, it's great to read them, because one of the common phenomena of them is that the people who get out there and they go through the tunnel and they come out into the light sort of thing, then sometimes they meet a kind of mentor or a guide or an angel or someone, and then they get sent back. And they just had a motorcycle accident or an auto accident or something, and they're on a surgical table and they don't want to go back. But bang, they're suddenly in there. Could they wake up out of their coma or whatever it is? You know, they come back. You know, and a lot of those stories. One woman who I liked wrote in the 80s, I think that was the first really popular embrace by the light bulb. She was a woman from a fundamentalist. She was a Native American, but she was a member of an evangelical group in Montana or something like that, or Idaho or something like that. And she was actually in the morgue. Her body was in the cooler. And she started telling me, hey, let me out of here, you know, the body bag. And was undamaged, brain was undamaged and everything. She was sent back by Jesus. We had her at our first Art of Dying conference here in New York. Big crowd, but unfortunately, her perception of Jesus told her, like, go criticize, scold those gay people. So it was not a popular talk at our conference. We didn't realize that her version of Jesus had a little problem in that. Or she brought with her conceptual apparatus some sort of homophobia, unfortunately. So, but she otherwise was wonderful, brilliant, beautiful thing. And those things are very good because you read a lot of them, you'll become less scared of your own death, even if you don't do anything else. But of course, you are all yogis and yoginis, or at least looking at it. By this course, you're not going to be able to do all this. You have to, it's a whole process, but we're finding out what it is. That's what we're trying to explain. Okay, so then we're back to the third stage, right? Which, as I said, is a tripartite, at least, thing of magic body, body isolation, body objective, mind isolation. Then prior to mind isolation is what's called speech isolation. And this is where mantra becomes important. Because mantra is the most kind of primal, most powerful, elemental form of speech. And this has to do with the Indian cosmology, which must have leaked out a little bit into Alexandria, because, you know, the Gospel of John, among the four officially approved Gospels by the Council of Nicaea in Christianity, the Gospel of John is says that thing about in the beginning was the Word, you know. So they realized somehow the power of the Word, the power of speech in creating the universe is kind of realized. But that's the Indian thing, as I think I've told you. The Indians feel when the universe is in a state, a particular universe, there's no one universe, there's multiverse, but when a particular universe is in a state of what they call pralaya, or dissolution, it's not that the energies are just sort of diffused, entropized, and just laying around somewhere like some sort of lazy atom or something, or lazy subatomic particle that's just out there floating in the breeze. What has happened is the consonant syllables are lying there, and the vowel power has disappeared from it. And the way the universe reemerges is the vowel comes, and it picks up the consonants, and they can be pronounced. And then from the seed syllables, the universe evolves from the seed syllables of the words. So in a sense, language does create reality. And language language creates body, language creates mind. It's like the genetic force of language is very, very apparent from ancient time to the Indian people. And so speech isolation is very, very important. And the basic thing of speech isolation brings us to one thing I want you to meditate on tonight, just to get a sense of it. And again, isolation means speech is isolates the practitioner, the yogi, from anything non-perfect and non-pure. Okay? So now go into meditative mode, meaning sit up, cross your ankles, sit up straight, etc. Don't take notes for a minute. You know, we're going to practice something. And, you know, imagine your central channel. And coming from your midbrow, but back in your skull, back in your brain a little bit, not right on the surface. And because you're not having a third eye, but it's sort of about that height. And it's sort of where it kind of, there's like a junction there where the right red channel and left white channel come up from your nostrils. And they all go along the top of your brain, kind of, or near the top of the brain, and they come to your crown. And then all three channels, blue one in the middle, red one on your right, white one on your left, they all take a turn and go straight down your body in front of your spine, in front of your cervical vertebrae and then your regular vertebrae, and down all the way to the perineum, at the below the pelvic bone, and then they hook forward toward the genital thing. That's the, although there are different ways. This is software. Don't worry. There's no like tubes in there, like wetware tubes. But it's not your veins, and it's not the ordinary. It is superimposed upon your nervous system, your channel system, but it's software. But you visualize it. And you're visualizing your body has no solid, no organs inside, no wetware, no intestine, no vessels, no organs, no lungs. It's just all, you're a light body. It's all made of light. Imagine, and you imagine this central channel going down the middle. Okay? And if possible, breathe through your nostrils. But it doesn't matter if you're congested or something. Just breathing normally. Now, at the crown chakra level, sort of the upper part of the brain, there is a white syllable om. Could have English, use English letters if you don't know the Tibetan or Sanskrit. And it has a whitish crystalline type of radiance. It's like jeweline. And actually it represents the body of all Buddhas. It's sort of physical. And in your throat center is the red letter ah, which is actually a long A, ah, with an H and a dot under it at the end, like because it ends in like a ch. So it's ah, you know, like a little bit of a glottal stop at the end of the long ah. So om, white om, and this ruby colored and radiates a ruby luminosity. And then at your heart center, sort of between the height of the nipples, but in the center and in the back, in the center of the central channel in the back, which is in front of the spine, though, not in the spine, but in front of it, is a blue hum. H, long U, and then an M with a dot on top, which is almost like a NG, like hum. So you don't really end on the closed lips, mm. It's going to go mm, as if the mm kind of goes down inside. Mm, hum, ah, hum. And that's it, that's sapphire, and radiates a sapphire radiance, deep, dark, blue-black. Okay. So just breathe normally. Think of those three syllables as shining there. If you can't hold this sense of stable, sense that they are there, never mind. But they are representing body, speech, and mind of all Buddhas. Om Ahong. Om Ahong. And now, when you inhale, and don't breathe too hard. When you pay attention to your breathing, of course, it's very hard not to interfere with it and like take extra deep breaths or breathe more quickly or, you know, move your diaphragm and your belly more, sort of fill up with air. And, you know, you kind of mess around with your breathing. When you think about your breathing, it's very hard not to. But try to breathe normally, although, you know, don't breathe too shallowly. If your normal breathing is nervous and shallow, then you could slow it down a little. And as you know, when you do mindfulness practice, I think a lot of you have done that, you watch your breathing, or you count your breath, actually, at the exhalation, usually where the air comes out of the nostrils. And you count 1 through 10, you know, and then your mind wanders and you bring it back. You know, that's sort of the root practice of satipatthana, you know, focus of mindfulness, focus of remembrance. So maybe many of you have done that. It's very similar to that, what we're doing now, but we're not counting. So now what the goal is, the practice is, where you inhale, as you're inhaling, the inhalation itself is Om. At first, when you start, you might think Om as you inhale. You don't pronounce it externally, but you might think it, like as if the inhalation was a humming Om, like that. And then as you do that, you imagine that a white light goes into the central channel. It comes from the nostrils, of course, but then it immediately enters the central channel at the height of the third eye, but more in the middle of the brain. And then it goes up to the crown, and then goes down, and just goes down into the heart chakra. And then in the heart chakra, there's a little, like a cave. And this white Om fills that cave. So you have the idea that the energy that comes in with the breathing goes up to the crown and goes down and stays at the heart. And then you catch your breath a little bit and hold it. After a while, you might hold it for a little while, but you don't need to hold it too long or something. And then when you hold it there, then it changes into the ruby red ah. And so there's a shining red light that shines out throughout your body from that heart center. And somehow you can associate that with the fact that as you hold your breath, you know, the oxygen you have taken in our Western model, the oxygen that you have taken in sort of diffuses out through the lungs into the bloodstream. But since you're meditating not without organs, you don't really necessarily get into that too much, but you just sort of fill up with this vibrant red light of life, of energy. And that's ah. And then you exhale slowly, and that ah letter changes into the deep blue hum. And the exhalation, you think hum as you exhale. You don't recite hum, but you think hum. And then if you do this practice, so then inhale om, hold it at the heart center, at that point in the center of the center channel. Ah. Exhale. Inhale. Om. Hold in the center. Ah. Exhale. Inhale. White energy. Om. Hold it, red energy, ah. Exhale, blue, black, dark blue energy, hum. Inhale, diamond, om. Hold it, ruby, red, ah. Exhale, sapphire, hum. Okay, ding. I'll tell you a little story. This is called, what we're doing is called the Vajra recitation, or the Vajra repetition. Vajra japa, the Sanskrit word is japa. And japa is what is also meant when if you recite a mantra, like Om Mani Padme Hum, Om Mani Padme Hum, if you recite Om Mani Padme Hum a lot of times, that's called repetition or recitation, you know, in mantra practice, you know, like somebody will have that exercise where, let's say, do 100,000 Om Mani Padme Hums, you know. Many Tibetan lamas actually, by older age, have already said many millions of Om Mani Padme Hum, for example. Tibetans are always saying Om Mani Padme Hum. So that's regular japa, you know, like Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum. Those are really great practices too. And sometimes if you do mindfulness practice by saying a mantra, instead of counting or your breath, but you just breathe normally and then you repeat Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum. And actually when you do it like that, you say it not in a loud voice, you murmur it with a low voice so that you don't scatter your mind too much. And then you can do mindfulness where when you're saying Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, because after you say it after a while, your tongue and lips and breath will automatically say the mantra. You don't have to think about saying Om Mani Padme Hum, Om Mani Padme Hum. It'll do it automatically, and then your mind will wander while you're still saying Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum. And so then you bring your mind back to just Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum. So you use it as a sort of thread for concentration, like you're using the counting, you know, when you do normal, you know, the way the Vipassana people teach mindfulness, beginning mindfulness, right? But Vajra Japa, you don't say anything. You don't say Om Ahum, Om Ahum, Om Ahum. At first you maybe visualize the white light, the red light when you hold, and at first maybe you don't hold for very long, because in a way we hold our breath for a second at the end of every inhale and every exhale. We hold the breath a little bit because we have to turn from exhaling to inhaling, from inhaling to exhaling, so there's a moment where, split second even, where it stands still. You know, then immediately starts to inhale or immediately starts to exhale, right? So there's a turning moment. So this is just prolonging the turning moment when you inhale, holding your breath just for a second or two, but after a while it might be longer. And the goal is where you make a non-duality of the breathing and the mantra so that the breath, the prana, the breath energy, wind energy, and the mantra with sound and light become one thing, so that you don't have to think Om, but when you inhale, it's Om. When you hold, it's Ah. When you exhale, it's Hum. So that's the goal. And that takes a lot of doing. And then they say, if you can do that every morning when you get up, if you can do that 1,080 times without losing concentration, you're getting really close to some high level of something. Speech isolation, you know. Third stage of perfection stage. But that's really tough to do. But my point is, I want to tell a story. My friend Dan Goldman, actually the guy who wrote the Little Force for Good book, and who promised me someday he's going to come to our ongoing Force for Good, or the eternal Force for Good course. But not yet. Maybe this spring. He was once in Dharamsala and had to get back to Delhi to get a flight to get somewhere to do something. But then the train was canceled and his flight was canceled. So he had to do what you do from Dharamsala. I don't know, some of you may have been to Dharamsala, but it's quite a rough drive, a long drive, 14-hour. In the old days, it used to be like 18-hour drive. And rough roads and dodging bullock carts and trucks, and it's really quite a thing. Grand Trunk Road. So he had to drive, and he was like really not looking forward to it, sort of packed into a taxi with his wife and some other people. And some lama that was a friend of his said, you know, you should try, as you're driving, when you inhale is Om, white Om, when you hold your breath, or even just turn your breath, it's red Ah, and when you exhale, it's Hum, blue Hum. So white, red, blue, you know, white, red, blue, white, red, blue. And then, you know, just get into doing that as you're driving, and then it'll go quickly at the time. It won't be like too frustrated and too nervous, upset for the long, bumpy the drive on the Indian road. And so he says he did that, and by the time he got to Delhi, he was like, he could have gone on another 10 hours or something, he claims, you know. And I'm sure it's true. And he had a really amazing experience, in other words, doing it. So there's ways, and then the Tenzin Wangyal, the Bumbo teacher, you know, who's well known here in America, has a center in Virginia and California, very nice guy. He says you should do that when you're waiting in a queue, in a long line, and you're feeling impatient. You can just use the time and inhale Om. Because the Bumbos use this too, you know. And then it's a red on. But there are different things of what you're visualizing, where there's Om and on Om, and that's all. There are different ways of doing that. But it's a great thing, and that's just to understand, that's what speech isolation leads to, and where it achieves, where it moves from speech isolation to mind isolation is, where at some point when you do that, in the holding moment, just naturally it slips into where all the energy goes into the central channel, and you go through the eight dissolutions, and you have a kind of, you touch clear light, you know, and come back, you know. So it's a way of opening, and very securely, because, you know, after all, Om is the body, is the oneness of the body of all Buddhas. The Ah is the oneness with the speech of all Buddhas. The Hum is the oneness with the mind of all Buddhas. So you're sort of feeling that it's all just Buddhas, body, speech, and mind, when you get to where it all goes in central channel, so you're not frightened. And it's not a completely super deep touching of the central, you know, clear light, but it's close, it's very powerful, it's said, when you achieve that. And you can spend months or years, in the Nagarjuna book, there's some excerpts from his chapter on the speech isolation, which talks about that. And, hello, there you are, yeah, so good. So this art is taught by the perfect Buddha like a ladder, for those stable in the creation stage and ambitious for the perfection stage. The life energy of beings doing all work is called wind, which really is just energy. Because wind is not just a breeze. That is not only wind. When I do that, the four elements in Buddhism are not just simplistically what we might think. Any atom in the old sort of simplistic Buddhist atom theory has elements of wind, fire, water, and earth. So when I do that, if I feel a little pressure on the skin, that's because there's some earth element atom in the atoms of my breath. The only wind part is the movement. Wind literally means movement. Yoa is defined as simply movement. The fire element is temperature. You know, so if my breath is a little warm on the hand, or room temperature or something, or different temperature than the, or cooler than the skin, then that's the fire element. And then the moisture that's there is the water element. And then the feeling of, and the wind element's only the movement. And the water element's only the sense of pressure or solidity, right? So they're just, they're abstractions in a way, the four elements, the four what are called primary elements. They're just abstraction. And actually in Tantra, there are four Buddhas, female Buddhas. Lochana, Mamaki, Pandaravasini, and Tara. Tara is movement, is wind, is energy. Tara is miracle working Tara. Is wind energy. So we say wind, sometimes I say wind energy, sometimes it's called wind. Or sometimes I had to do it here because prana is one of the five kind of winds. There's 10 kind of winds. There's actually 108 type of winds. But the simple way is five main winds, five branch winds. And that's the very complicated inner physiology of the subtle body, which are winds or energies, channels and drops. You know, as I think you've seen in the schemes we've showed that. So it is the mount of consciousness, fivefold and tenfold in nature. That's the five winds, 10 winds. Through realization of creation by mantra, one is trained in the vajra repetition. He says, the yogi abhyanga, you can translate also as recitation. I switched to japa to repetition in this case because you're not reciting anything, actually. Just breathing is om, inhaling is om, exhaling is hum, and holding or the turning is ah, like that. This is the perfection yoga, and the great Vajradhara supreme in all ways is born from that. Since the three states, past, present, and future, are purified through clear light, he sees them all at once. These truths abide well sealed in the glorious communion tantra. That's Agnya Samaja. Nowadays I translated that as community, not communion. I save communion for Yoganatha. They should be understood from the Guru's speech in accordance with the explanatory tantras. Who devotedly always strives in service and worship, who retains his learning, such a one need not be examined by the superior Guru. He should be given the Guru's grace. Who falls from the summit of a high mountain may think, I mustn't fall, but he will fall. Who obtains the helpful prophecy by the Guru's kindness may think, I should not be delivered, yet he will be delivered. So that's, because that's the beginning, there's a lot more technical things about time of day that you practice the Vajra repetition, and then very complicated things like you have 900 breaths that go into a certain quarter of the nostril, and they are associated with different female Buddhas, and it's very complicated. Now, before that is the body isolation. And the body isolation in this way of counting in Nagarjuna's five stages is really lumped back into the creation stage. But in other systems, it's the perfection stage, but it fits very closely with what's called the subtle level of the creation stage. For example, when you, you visualize yourself as Guhya Samaja, as a six-armed, three-faced, two-legged deity, dark blue color, faces are blue, white, and red, etc., you know, and either male or female forms. And when you do that, that's actually what's called coarse, and in the building mandala, and you visualize the mandala universe, and all of this, the hologram around you. And then you visualize the other beings who are around there, who in a way are you, but they're also other deities. That's all coarse creation stage. When you do subtle creation stage, you create an inner mind. Your body becomes the building, and you have like different bodhisattvas in the eye, ear, nose, tongue, in the body, in different parts of the body, and they are. So that you're made of Buddhas. Your body is like made of Buddhas. And then it's sort of super subtle one, there's like many Buddhas, like in the white of your eye, there's four Buddhas. And then, and all the moisture in your body is a Buddha. I mean, it gets really complicated so that, you know, every fingernail is a different Buddha, the finger joints are a different one. Your body becomes a whole mandala and a whole community of deities. And then finally, pretty much the atoms are all Buddhas in your body, which is already taught exoterically, like in those visions of Samantabhadra, you know, the mutual interpenetration of all things in the flower ornament that we talked about. Remember where Samantabhadra is in every atom, and where you imagine when you do a bow or when you make an offering or you make a prayer that you are in every atom of the field around you and you're in another universe, same size as this universe, but packed into every atom in this universe, and you're doing the same thing, millions of you in all these different atoms. Oh, Lord, I caught that. All these different atoms are doing millions of different things. And those are all in the direction of the subtle creation stage, where you reach body isolation, and therefore that means that all your notion of body becomes all Buddha substance, you could say. So it's all Buddhas. And it's like, you know, a person who is in that stage, you know, there's the four purifications, for example, they talk about, where this is not a concrete building with concrete walls, but this is the heavenly palace of Guhya Samaja. And all this is all an illusion, but it's actually really made of light, and the pillars are all jewel. And the other beings are not really ordinary meat space, flesh and blood beings, but they're all of you are bodhisattvas and Buddhas and so forth. And oneself is a bodhisattva and Buddha. And the era is, you know, etc. In other words, you sort of superimpose, you move into an alternate reality. The way of being able to move is that it's all emptiness. And even the ordinary one that you are in, habitual one, you have come to become aware by developing more your insight into emptiness that you are also constructing it. In other words, you're placing the concepts of things that you can imagine on the pillar and the chair and the person and the toe and the foot and the shoe and the wire. And so But not you alone, because through language and culture and being in social communities, other people are simultaneously also visualizing these things like that. But actually, we're visualizing the world that we walk around in, actually. It's not like it's out there solidly like that. It looks different to different kinds of beings, which we normally won't realize. But the more we contemplate voidness or emptiness, the more we will realize that. And therefore, the more we will realize that we're actually in the process of visualizing our environment all the time. And actually, for convenience sake, because we want to like maneuver around within the reality, it happens so fast in the brain, in our habit and culture and language, everything, that we think that's a painting and that the paintingness of the painting is in the painting. That's how we attribute falsely intrinsic identity, intrinsic objectivity, and intrinsic reality to the painting. Do you follow me? And we all learned that already in Madhyamaka, in the exoteric philosophical thing when we talked about it, right? So you're all familiar with that. But viscerally speaking, the more deeply we get into it, and the more we are aware that we are co-creating the world with other beings and even with objects around us, the more creativity we have free, and therefore the more powerfully we can visualize. And then in visualizing, then we really can move into this kind of what they would call divine, or really almost you should say Buddhine reality, Buddha reality. This is all a mandala and so on. You follow? And also move back so that we don't stand out in the street in front of the Fifth Avenue bus and say, "Oh, you're like a divine carriage," like, and get run over. We can shift back into our ordinary thing, and realize, oh, that's a bus and it's heading right for me, and we jump out of the way in time. And that's why, to really do, and then when there's, they take 3-year retreats or they go for 5 years in this case. Tsongkhapa, for example, went from 1392 basically until 1398, really basically 6-7 years. Manjushri told him to go and retreat, even though he was already a great teacher and he had a lot of invitations to teach, he withdrew and went on retreat. Because you kind of have to be in a protected space to really go really deeply into all that. Oh. Okay, so that's the body. So sometimes they count body isolation, speech isolation, mind isolation, slash clear light, slash magic body, and then clear light stage or manifest enlightenment, and then communion. And then there's learner's communion and non-learner's communion, which is actual Buddhahood, and learner's communion is almost Buddhahood. But still, someone can spend years already after magic body plunging again and again and again into clear light. So for example, this whole thing about Tantra is the quick way, it's the super fast and all this. It doesn't mean weekend retreat versus like the 1 month retreat. It means within a life or a few lives as opposed to millions of lives. It's what it means. Although then, they have that saying, 3 years, 3 days, 3 months, that if you really do it properly and you have all the prerequisites, you can become a Buddha. They say that. But once the Dalai Lama, in one teaching where there were a couple of people who had 3-year retreats, he said, when someone tells me that they've done the 3-year retreat and now they're Buddha, he said, it makes me feel like laughing, he said. And a lot of them go back for another 3 and another 3 and another 3 when they really do it well, actually, if they can afford it, So it's arduous, It's climbing Mount Everest, this kind of thing, in a way. So hopefully you've understood that from me explaining this. That's the point of explaining it. Now, I want to come back to one major point, and that is around the mind isolation and the magic body thing. How are we doing time-wise? Oh my goodness, we almost finished. Is that really 8:52 or am I on Nepal in time? Oh, so we're almost done. Okay, so therefore, then for example, Ati Yoga, like I wanted to talk about this. This beautiful thing, this Ati Yoga, which is these, which I, as I said, I think it's the top 2.5 stages of the perfection stage, or the great perfection, I believe, or Ati Yoga. And So when people say Maha Great Seal or Atta Yoga, that, you know, I go to this Lama, I get initiated in Great Seal or Great Perfection or something like that, and I've done those things, and that's great. And then they sort of give you the, when you get initiated into the five perfection stages in the systems, in the new yogic systems, of the new tantric systems, this is the old Nyingma tantric system. The new tantric systems are Kagyu, Sakya, Geluk, Kadam. There's a bunch of the new schools. New means starting in the 11th century. Old means starting in the 8th century. And then continuing in the 11th century, so then the old becomes a separate school. But basically they're still all pretty much the same, but they just rely on different texts. Some people translate the old one as the ancient one, but it's really not. They're not ancient. After the 11th century, they're also practicing, and they're 11th century Buddhists and 15th century Buddhists and 20th century Buddhists themselves. But they say old because they're relying on the older versions of the tantric translations that were made in the 8th century. And that's the only difference, really. And the older classification of tantras that was made in the 8th century, which then there's a little bit changed in India, so that then the new translations done in the 10th, 11th, 12th centuries have a slightly different system. That's the only difference, really. And then, anyway, when they give you these things in that, what they're doing is the same thing that you do in initiation. In initiation, at some point they say, now the fourth initiation in the new schools, the highest one, is where they say, well, now you're a Buddha. They say that in the ritual. And you're supposed to feel, oh, great, now I'm a Buddha. And then that's the end of the initiation. Then you go for the instruction, and then they say, oh, well, now they're preliminaries. And then that goes on for years. You're a Buddha, but now you're going to bow 100,000 times. Now you're going to do 100,000 guru pujas. Now you're going to do 100,000 this and that and the other. And then there's a lot of exoteric studies and deepening your shunyata and so on, deepening your compassion and your bodhisattva spirit and so on. So they're all the same like that in a way. You know. There's no, unfortunately, way of just, now you're a Buddha and then you're going to be Buddha. There was a lady, dear friend of mine, who recently passed away, sadly, who was there with us in 1981 when Dalai Lama first did Kalachakra in Wisconsin. And then we had a course in Amherst where we used to be teaching, and we had a Buddhist Studies Institute before we were asked to do Tibet House. And we had a course in the summer on how to use the Kalachakra initiation, how to do some Kalachakra practice. And in the first day of the first class, as we were explaining something about the mandala and the body of the Kalachakra and the sadhanas and the preliminaries of the sadhana, the sort of the practice contemplative sequence that you do, it's very complicated. And there's all these complicated things you do and verses to recite or whatever, even the simplest form. So about 15 minutes into the first class, there was suddenly this like horrified shriek, but not exactly shriek, but sort of outcry from the back of the room. This lady say, what? We have to do all these complicated things, but we already got the initiation. And I was saddled with the very sad duty of explaining that the initiation is just a doorway. And if you go through the doorway, then there's a tremendous amount of things to learn, things to do, things to practice, and so on. So, you know, I know many because we're in the course this spring that we've come up to this talking about perfection stage in this next to last class. And in the last class, I'm going to be delighted to have the author of this Nyingma Atta Yoga book and also Dr. Nita to be here with me next week from today. But I hope you all can make it. And he's presenting his book in a way, but which we have the book out there. It's a really great book. And I especially love it because it's Yutong, who was a great doctor, which I was initiated in 1964, and I never really properly worked on it much. But I'm now beginning to do so, thanks to Dr. Nita, a little bit. Because I really, it's beautiful. Tibetan medicine system is something exquisite, really, it really is. It's not like it's going to solve everything at all, but, and itself is a, and one of the great things about it is it likes modern medicine. It like not everything that they do because they don't always use it right, but it likes it, and this things that is invented and the magnification of things is pretty good, but it thinks that it has a problem, And once I was I was translating for the Dalai Lama's physician in a conference, and somebody in the conference, Western sort of scientist, doctor type, was saying like, "Oh, you guys and your alternative things, your Asian medicine system, you're so simplistic. All you have is like earth, water, fire, wind, space, five elements, you know, and we have 129 periodic table of elements, and we're really so sophisticated, we're really cool, like, what's the matter with you guys?" And so the doctor he was very combative, that the doctor, he liked to debate, he was very intelligent and very combative. So he said, "Well," he said, "if you want us to do that, we have a way of doing that." He said, "We can take the five elements, and then each one is subdivided in five, and that's 25, and then each of those is subdivided in five, we get 125, then we subdivide that, and then we get 625. No problem. We can get as analytic as you want, and we like you being analytic. That's great, your table of elements, everything, your atomic things, and that's wonderful," he said. "But as healers, you guys have Humpty Dumpty the human being," he said. But this is speaking in Tibetan, I'm translating. So he goes, "Humpty Dumpty, Kerazade, Misem Jendela, Humpty Dumpty Jebri." And I thought it was a Tibetan word I didn't know. And I said, "What do you mean Humpty Dumpty? What is this Humpty?" He says, "No, Humpty Dumpty." I said, "Well, what do you mean Humpty Dumpty?" "Oh, in English, Humpty Dumpty. Okay." Very funny. And of course, what he meant was, by this super analytic thing, and right in that same conference, actually, I had had a vision while translating for him. One of the scientists there who was talking about T cells, you know, and they were getting this thing, and it was going there to reinforce the T cell, this and that, and I suddenly had a vision of him, like a skin diver, you know, like a spaceman. He had like goggles, and he had a suit on, and he was in the micro world, like Ant-Man, you know, down there in the blood. He was chasing some T cell, looking for a white corpuscle, and he was out there in the bloodstream. He was totally unaware of the whole thing because he was in this micro world, in his mind, you know, in his imagination. I actually had a vision, so it was around the same time that he was thinking like that, I think. So anyway, he says, "You've Humpty Dumpty the human being. Yeah, you can analyze into elements and matters and everything like that, but then you don't even know whether to tell that person to eat spinach or broccoli. You have no idea. You know, you can't put it together. It's not that the analytic is you're not good, it's great, but then how do you reassemble it when you're dealing with an actual life situation? That's where you need a certain healing skill that you guys lack. And your side effects thing." And he even had this theory, which I think is really cool. I'd like to see that develop more, which I didn't have to do. But when you know, the whole thing of where that's an herb like Artemisia or something, and it helps when you have fever. Oh, great. But now we're going to isolate the active element of it, and we're going to make it much more powerful by isolating the active agent in the herb, you know. And he said, you know, when you do that, this doctor, he said to those people, he said, when you do that, you take out something that you perceive to be the active element, and you don't realize that in nature, the thing has been for long history, long interaction with beings and everything. It's embedded in there with other elements, which don't seem to you to be so active, but they kind of buffer the presence of that active thing. So that then when you take that into the system of a living being who's developed an embodiment of something that's had a huge genetic history, its species has, or its, you know, its ancestors have had in dealing with that vegetable, or something like that vegetable for thousands of years, when you take the active and put it in, then it's going to suck out of that person's chemistry all kinds of things that are going to create side effects that you don't know what they are, because it's going to want to be buffered by things that are not necessarily active, and even then could be harmful by depleting them out of other parts of the chemical system of the person. But they didn't, I don't think they didn't quite understand what he was trying to say, but I got that. I think that was really, so like, you know, they have like herbal compounds with 35 different things in them, and then they pick the thing, and then when the moon is in this stage and that and a certain season, it's really complicated. In their own botanical, experimental, experiential over thousands of generations of use of these different things and interacting with the nature around them, you know. Just like, you know, the wise women in Europe had the cure for the common cold, but then they got burned as witches. So then now we don't even know what it is. We have Sudafed, you know, but that doesn't cure it. That doesn't cure it. And common cold is curable. If you had this herb and that thing and some kind of soup, then those ladies knew that. Anyway, never mind. So it's a beautiful system because it can, it, you know, like it embraced Greek medicine, Persian medicine, Chinese medicine, Indian medicine, under the light of the Buddha insight about the nature of things, the transparency, clear light, and fold them all in. And now it's ready to like sort of help discern within the modern thing what's good and what's not good. And they could have told them a long time ago that chemotherapy is poison, and too much poison when a person's detoxification process, liver and kidneys, is already weakened, so they have mutant cells forming growths that are not helpful to the functioning of the organism, would not really be, it would really knock the immune system right off the cliff. No. Never mind. They could have told them that a long time ago. Now they're targeting, you know, they're getting better, and that's good. So next time we will talk about, so that's it. Oh yeah, oh, I wanted to, last thing I wanted to say, but I don't really have time. Maybe I can do it next time if Dr. Nita gives me a little time. And what I wanted to talk about, just very briefly, let me say, one of the reasons that Westerners have hated Tantra, and one of the reasons that Dalai Lama wants us to tell people what it is because there is this thing about so-called, quote, sexual yoga in Tantra. And where that becomes essential, something that seems like sexual yoga, but it isn't regular sexuality at all, is at that third stage of creation, of perfection stage, where you're entering the central channel, all the energies, you know, which means you are simulating meditatively a death experience. So you're right in the area of death. You know, you unravel the heart knot, your consciousness continuum, which is not a fixed thing, but the continuum of it at a very subtle plane in the heart center is sort of free floating. You're on the edge of the clear light where you're everything. And you're also in a space of bliss where you're actually not that interested in your previous coarse body. Like those near-death experiences I was trying to say, those people don't really want to go back, even when they didn't have an auto accident, but they died from some other cause. They don't want to go back, but then, you know, Jesus or whoever they think the guide is says, sorry, it's not your time, get back to business. Go back and deal with your uncle and aunt and parents and children and whatever it is, and go vote. Go vote for the first female president, not for some lunatic. So I wanted to, they don't care about it because they're out in bliss, you see. So the point is, at that stage, there needs to be the partner. Now, there doesn't have to be the physical partner. The extremely sensitive one can have what's called a wisdom partner, which means, or an intuition partner, which means like a subtle-bodied angelic being can come and have a full union with that. They have maybe practiced in creation stage themselves as two beings, but they need a partner there. And the reason is that they actually, in magic body practice, they go into a dream state and they actually do leave the physical body. And the partner has to be at the same level. So the partner has to be totally trained, totally I know about emptiness, totally have bodhisattva thing, totally have renunciation level. Can't just be some male, if your person is a female, or some female just off the street. It cannot, because that person is like driven by instinct to want to have ordinary sexuality. And they might have orgasm, but it will be very short-lived because they're not getting all the energy into the central channel at the navel, heart, throat, and brain level, just at the genital level, at the opening, lower opening of central channel. It's like what we would call, what Mr. Freud would call, genitally organized sexuality. Procreative, you know, ordinary human habitual sexuality. So the consort practice, you know, at that stage, at the third stage, is some kind of really complicated yoga. There's no ejaculative spasm, either by male or female. There's, instead, at the point of the melting, you know, in the genital thing, the orgasmic energy is sent inward in both partners, up to the channels and chakras. The knots have been opened, and the sensitivity is completely suffused and flooded with bliss, both people. And it's not just the ordinary conclusion, you know, or what somebody might, some one teacher might say, not the ordinary huffing and puffing routine. It's not going on. And even there's a cut point where there's no breathing at all. Both are in a kind of trance where there's hardly any breathing because they've already achieved the speech isolation. Both sides, both partners have to have ordinarily achieved that where the breathing is om ah hum. completely. And also both are perceiving that even every fiber of their own body as deity, as Buddhas. There's no ordinary human interaction there at all for it to actually work. Because if either one of them wanted to have an ordinary sort of sexual, you know, interactions, you know, like, you know, then that would disrupt completely the concentration of the other one. And then neither one would get there, if you follow me. So if both are yogis or and yoginis, if you actually have what's called the karma mudra or the evolutionary, I always translate karma as evolution, evolutionary seal, you know. And they're because they're reaching to a point of the Mahamudra, and the Mahamudra, the universal seal or the great seal, means where even looking at this pillar is like making love with the light energy from the pillar. It's orgasmic, just seeing the pillar. And that's at an earlier stage, you're visualizing your eye sense faculty as the Bodhisattva Kshitigarbha, the essence of earth or the womb of earth, and the form object, physical object, solid object is Rupa Vajra, the diamond goddess of form or of matter. And there and having a visual experience is therefore lovemaking, orgasmic mutual melting of the Bodhisattva and the goddess, and the Buddha goddess, female Buddha. You follow me? So everything is like that. So it's nothing, it's not normal huffing and puffing, is the point. It's very abnormal. But it's much more intense, they say, and I hope that's true. I do. We'll see. Some future life of mine, I will see. And that's why, you know, so that's a key point I just wanted to make. I can do more detail. I actually gave a talk at a Buddhological conference in Norway with all the international community of Tibetan Buddhism scholars and some Indian Buddhism scholars. They were all horrified because they all had that, they wanted to stick with their idea that the Tantra is some sort of excuse for a bunch of horny monks to run out and grab some girls in the bazaar and like have an orgy or something. Which is because they're so disrespectful to the ancient Asian or even modern Asian people. They're so unaccepting of the high exalted level of these amazing traditions and the inner neurological science of these things. They really are, you know. So I just wanted to make that point. But that's a key point. And then the death imagery of the fierce deity. So therefore you have the erotic imagery of the male-female deities and so on. And the death imagery of like ferocious deity, like Yama Antaka, the terminator of the death. You know, I like to say the terminator, you know, like because we have Arnold, you know, in the movie, the Terminator, right? But that's the Indian terminator was Yama. Yama had the head of an Indian buffalo trading on some primal human thing of the fearing an ox, you know, or a wild yak, or a wild cow, you know, a wild bull, you know, trampling them, you know, like, you know, the Minotaur, you know, this kind of fear. So the Indian god of death was like a big Minotaur. But then Manjushri Buddha appears in the form of the death of death. That's a multiple Minotaur at the Minotaur. And he makes death become a nice guy. Instead of going around clubbing people, death becomes just a transition point and all this kind of thing. So the death of death is this brilliant, wonderful Buddhist thing of eternal life. Because once death dies, then nobody dies, right? You get that. So the fear stuff has to do with the fact that these great bliss states of oneness with the thing and the clear light thing, it is in the normal chain of life, it is the death state. And when the death state is seen as outside of the life state and the end of it, actually, and the beginning of the between, and then a new life based on uncontrolled instinct, a new life you don't know where, drawn by your habitual reactions with no self-control, like we have a dream with no self-control, no self-awareness even, then death is a really bad thing because you don't know what the next life is going to be and you're going to have a next life, the idea. But when death dies, then your consciousness is one unending crescendo of clear light, reaching Buddhahood. And then only manifesting, really, any kind of embodiment for the benefit of other beings, altruistically, period. It's really beautiful, actually. If it's real. Could be all complete delusion, I agree. But I don't think so. It's truly marvelous. Because it means something else for science, too. It means that science is based on We have to be scientists, and we have to rediscover reality, but actually the greatest of scientists, and many of them, have already discovered complete, thoroughly reality, and have given us method of discovering it for ourselves. Unfortunately, the fact that they discovered doesn't finish the job, and we can just sort of say, okay, save me. We have to, each one of us, discover it ourselves, actually. That's the difference, you know. It's like you can't just say, oh, the guys over in the Institute for Advanced Studies, they're going to figure it all out, and then we'll be cool, and we'll just drive up and down on the bus or the subway. No, each of us has to figure it out to really be able to be in tune with the reality that we're actually in, are, in and are, and of, right? Okay, thanks very much, and too late, you know, if you have burning questions, you can email me. By the way, where's Banu? I don't see Banu tonight. She didn't come. She sent me a big email about shunyata and things, and I'll try to answer slowly. You know that nice lady who always asked about emptiness? Turkish lady. She didn't show up tonight. Okay, take care. See you next time.